Okay, let's get started. Did you guys get a good lunch?
Yes.
I hope so. Okay, nice. Okay, so let me introduction myself first. So I'm Takanori. I have been living in Singapore since 2016. And before coming to Singapore, I was working as a data IT infrastructure engineer in Tokyo for 8 years. And after that, I decided to come to Singapore to study business analytics in National University of Singapore here. And after took a master's degree, I found a job as a data scientist. So since then, I'm working as a data scientist here. So currently, I'm working a couple of data-driven projects, such as the natural language processing. And also, I'm working for the recommendation engine. And also, not only analyzing the data, I'm also working integrating this kind of data science machine learning solution into the production system as well. So I'm basically I'm interested in some like machine learning mathematical theory as well as the IT infrastructure technology. So today's topic is the more IT infrastructure side rather than machine learning stuff. So today I'm going to talk about the stream processing, and also I will talk about the technology stack to implement stream processing. So which are Apache Kafka and Spark structured streaming. And not only just in introducing technology, but also I created some simple demo to show like how can we implement streaming data processing by using Python. Yeah, because this is a Python conference, so yeah. Okay, so today's session, I'm targeting to an audience such as the data engineer or data scientist and or any Python developer, Python lovers who are interested in streaming processing. And I'm going to cover some kind of basic concept, basic topic. So if you have not familiar with the streaming processing, hopefully my session will help you guys start to have an interest for the streaming processing, hopefully. And what I will talk today is the overview of Apache Kafka and the Spark structured streaming technologies, and also how to create a simple application in Python. So last night I uploaded the code on GitHub. So you can check after this session. And today I will not talk about system architecture and parameter tuning and optimization of the Kafka and the Spark. And also I don't talk about the system configuration procedure, how to create a Kafka and the Spark structured streaming environment. Because these topics are like too big to cover in just one session. And I also, actually in industry there are so many solutions to realize implement a streaming processing such as Apache Beam, et cetera. But just some like pros and cons, I don't deep dive into it. So basically I focus on the explaining Apache Kafka and the Spark structured streaming. Okay, so first of all, I talk about the what is stream processing. So I suppose many of you already know about the batch processing, right? So batch processing is basically we collect that data and process that data in a batch style. For example, one of the example could be, okay, so we are running an e-commerce website and we have each transaction data, like user A purchase item one, user B purchase item two, something like that. And every day we want to know how many user purchase item one, or how many item purchase in a single day. So to do so, we collect our data in the, let's say, October 1st, all of transaction data, then try to aggregate to get some amount, how many item are purchased, and how many, in this user, how many item purchased by this user, something like that. So to do so, like we have our October 1st data in the morning of October 2nd, then we can run the batch processing on the next day. So and the pre-scheduled timeline, let's say like every morning we aggregate that data every morning. So by using yesterday's data, this is a batch processing. On the other hand, string processing concept is different. So basically we get kind of real-time or semi-real-time data. And data is basically piece by piece. So we process that data some periodically, like very short time span, such as the every 10 seconds, or even we can process the upon data, new data arrival, or we can process by some like we define an event trigger and running processing. So this is a high level comparison between the batch processing and the stream processing. So batch processing, we can run schedule timing such as every 1 a.m. or every Sunday 3 a.m. etc. But in stream processing, we just run more like short time span or some like a triggered event time. And basically data sources, many of them are in common, but in streaming processing, it has a capability to process some like a real time or semi-real time data. And also regarding the output storage, definitely in batch processing, we have to like dump out the data into the relational database or file or object storage, anything. But sometimes streaming processing, we store the same like similar data sources, but in streaming process, we are not necessary to store the persistent storage. We just, let's say, process the streaming data and send back to the client device. Then we don't. Then data is no longer exists. Yeah, such a way, so streaming processing, sometimes we don't store the data. It depends on the business use case. And regarding the performance metrics, so in batch processing, we should think of this throughput, which means how many records are processed. And on the other hand, in streaming processing, latency is important. So how much time to take to process in each piece of data? Because latency is very high, then the quality of service might be affected. Okay, so this is a high-level technology stack to the implement a streaming processing. So let's say we have some like stream data source, and let's say like we have a mobile device and we keep sending a data to the some data hub, which is one example is Kafka, and the Kafka ingest that data, and then Kafka send to streaming processing infrastructure, or sometimes Kafka just directly store to the object storage such as AWS S3 or Google Cloud Storage. And even after Spark process the streaming data, sometimes we store the data in the permanent persistent storage such as the HDFS or Postgres SQL or NoSQL data store. Even after processing via Spark, data can be sent back to the Kafka, and then Kafka also send back to the like client device or send the data to the object storage. So system configuration can be very flexible. It depends on the business requirement and what we want to achieve. Okay, so first of all, I'm going to explain about the Kafka. So Kafka is basically middleware to messaging middleware, which is the distributed and the resilient and the fault tolerant and the scalable messaging infrastructure. So which means we can create a Kafka cluster and each node, we can run the Kafka process. So we can do a multi processing and we can distribute a process. So it realizes high scalability to process big data. And As a messaging middleware perspective, Kafka is a publish-subscribe messaging model. So basically, like data sender, if you want to send a data, yeah, sender publish a data, and as a data consumer, consumer just subscribe a topic and just pull a data from the broker. So basically, Kafka can be a kind of data hub in between the diverse data source, which is so-called producer, and also can a bridging between the producer and the consumer. So basically, so by doing so, Kafka decouples system dependencies. So which means by using Kafka, we can ingest diverse data source, and Kafka can like send a data to multiple, like a data store. It makes the system more flexible. And the good thing of Kafka is that there are many API, convenient APIs available. So we can use the Python API for Kafka for sending a data to Kafka broker, and also can consume data by using a Python API. So Kafka originally developed by LinkedIn, but currently, the company so-called Confluent is a mainly maintained open source project, and many big companies are using Kafka to process big data. So this is the architecture of the Kafka. So mainly there are three players. One is the producer. So basically, they are processing the data. They send the data to the Kafka cluster. And the second player is a Kafka broker. So broker is basically receive data from producers and send that data to consumer upon the request from the consumer side. And so needless to say, producer can be a multiple node, so multiple node can send that data to the Kafka broker. And also, broker can be multiple node, which means if the amount of message are very significantly high, like increasing, we can increase the broker node to make it more scalable. And how Kafka manage a message is the Kafka basically manage each messaging queue by using a topic. Let's say we create a topic A, then producer send a message to a broker with a topic A. Then consumer pull out data from topic A. By doing so, we can manage to cooperate with a multiple node and managing one single queue from the multiple node. And also, consumer also can be multiple node. So we can define the consumer group, let's say alpha, and the consumer group alpha consists of the consumer one and two. Both of them can pull data from the Kafka broker. So it makes the Kafka more scalable. So this is an explanation slide how Kafka manages messaging queue. So basically, Kafka manages some concept of the offset. For example, there is a commit offset, which means the commit offset is a pointer to the last record that the consumer has successfully processed, which means in this example, Kafka already send the data packet 1 and 2, and the consumer managed to process them. Then, so that's why the 1 and 2 are grayed out. And Kafka also has another offset, which is current offset, which means current offset is a pointer to the last record that Kafka has already sent to a consumer in the most recent polling. So by using this offset variable, Kafka try to send that data as much as it's accurate. So next, I'm going to explain about the Apache Spark. So I suppose many of you already heard about the Apache Spark. So Spark is basically it's a like parallel processing engine, and Apache Spark has a multiple technology stuff. So basic wise, Apache Spark Core, which implements some API for processing RDD data structure. And on top of the Apache Spark Core, there are some framework are also implemented. One is the Spark SQL. So Spark SQL enable developer to use a data frame and a dataset API, which are more convenient compared to the using original RDD data structure. Also, Apache Spark provides a framework, so-called Spark Streaming, and also provide a MLVM, which is a machine learning framework and a graphics. But however, so what I'm going to talk about the not Spark Streaming, actually. I'm going to talk about the Spark Structured Streaming. So naming is quite similar, but it's a different framework with the Spark Streaming. So Spark Structured Streaming is built on top of the Spark SQL framework, so which means we can deal with streaming data with the data frame and the dataset API, so which is more easy to use compared to the original Spark Streaming. So the basic concept of Spark Structured Streaming is the basically, we use a data frame, a Spark data frame API. So, but to do so, we need to handle a stream data. But in Spark Structured Streaming, it uses a concept of unbounded table. So let's think of each data packet come to the Spark Structured Streaming. So okay, we think of each data piece as a new input table, new record, new one line of record. And Spark Structured Streaming keep appending a new input table in the cumulative way on the unbounded table. So by doing so, we realizing like processing us streaming data with a like kind of cross tabular data by using a data frame API, which is handling a cross tabular data format. So this is an example from the official website of Spark structured streaming. So let's say we are going to do a word count. For example, like at time equal one, we receive a data which has a cat, dog, and also we get another data packet which includes a dog. So what we want to do is we just want to count how many words are coming through. So in this example, like there's one cat and there are three dogs. So then what we output is that just output, character is too small, but cat equal one and dog equal three. And the next time window, we get another streaming data, which is the old and the cat. And what we do is we just summing up these words on top of the previous output, which means the previously, cat equal one, but we get a new cat, so cat equal two, cat becomes two, and the dog equal three, and we get a new word also, all equal one. So we are getting data, and Spark structured streaming keep accumulating these data as a unbounded in a unbounded table. But not only just accumulating a streaming data that we have been receiving, but also Spark can do some data aggregation according to the event, so-called event time window based aggregation. Like in this example, we receive a data. So, okay, let's say we receive a data cat talk in the 12-2, and 1 minute later we also get the two-word dog and dog. Then we store data word count with the time window that we defined. So here, what we are going to do is count a word within 10 minute time windows. And time window is a slide every 5 minutes, which means we accumulate a word count in specific time window. First time window is from the 12 to 12:10, and the second time window is 12:05 to 12:15, and so on and so forth. So not only just counting a raw data, but also we can accumulate data according to the event timestamp that streaming data include. So by doing so, we accumulate, we can count a word count, not only by just word itself, but also the time window that we defined. And also we can, so sometimes streaming data comes very late, due to some network issues. In that case, what we can do is we can set the high water mark in order to dispose of data if data is arriving very, very late. Yeah, so these are the high-level concept of the Kafka and the Spark structured streaming. Okay, so from now on, I'm going to talk about the application example by Python. Okay, so suppose we have three devices, and each device send the data periodically to the Kafka. And suppose each data is consist of this kind of JSON object. Each data packet including a device ID and a timestamp, and its speed and the readings of the accelerometer of three dimension XYZ. So let's assume three devices keep sending data, this kind of IoT device data to Kafka. So in this exercise, what I did is I created a demo program to processing data, this streaming data by using Kafka and the Spark structured streaming and the data aggregator data. So procedure is as follows. So first of all, we have to set up Kafka and the Spark environment. We have to install a middleware and set up network stuff, et cetera. But I skip this part. So what we do is, first of all, we create a Kafka topic after installing a Kafka. And run the program which send to data to the Kafka broker. Then, after sending the data, then as a Kafka consumer, Spark structured streaming processes data by pulling data from broker and passing data and aggregate data, then output to a result. So that's a high level flow of what I'm going to explain. So I created a demo environment, but actually, I just created an environment in my local laptop. So I install everything in one laptop. Even I set up a Kafka producer and a Kafka broker and a Kafka consumer, which is a Spark structured streaming in this example. Everything I install in the one laptop. So first of all, I create a Kafka topic, just running a this command Kafka topics and hyphen create and specify like zookeeper and some parameter and specify the topic name that I want to create. So after I create a Kafka topic, then what I'm gonna do is I create a program to send that data to Kafka broker. So you can find this code on the GitHub, so you can refer after this session, but I will briefly explain what's gonna happen. So first of all, Kafka provides an API for the producer, so I just import the Kafka producer library. And I set up some like a parameter for Kafka. So I have to specify Kafka broker's host name and also the broker's port number to send the data to Kafka. And I also specify a set of variable for specifying a Kafka topic. Then next step is create a Kafka producer instance. Then next line is basically just reading a CSV file from data frame. This is just for the demonstration purpose because I don't have an actual IoT device, so I just create a CSV file to mimic IoT generated data. So to send the data, I just load this CSV file as a data frame. The next step is I create a for loop to sending a data to a Kafka broker periodically. So what I do is I load the data as a data, demo data as a data frame, but I convert to the JSON format, something like this. And after converting to JSON format, I send the data to Kafka broker by using a producer.send send method. What I do is I just specify name of topic, and I just specify a data format, UTF-8. So then by running a previous program, we can send that data to each IoT data to the Kafka broker. Then Next task is from the consumer, Kafka consumer side. So Kafka consumer has to pull a data from the broker to process our data. So how we pull a data is it's very simple. So this is a program from consumer side. So first of all, just import a library for PySpark and the Kafka consumer. And set up some like variable, and okay. Then we start a Spark session. Then and this part is corresponding to a logic to pull out data from Kafka topic. So what we do is we call a spark.readstream method, and we specify format as Kafka, and also we specify the Kafka broker host name and the port number and topic name as well. So by doing so, we can receive data from the Kafka broker, and basically we receive data as a bunch of bytecode. So first of all, we have to convert that data into the string format by running this code. So, and after converting a string, so what we want to do is we want to convert this kind of JSON string into the cross tabular format. So to do so, we have to do JSON parsing. The way we do a JSON parsing is first of all, we define a schema. Okay, so this is a string data sent from the Kafka broker. So what we want to do is we want to convert this JSON object into this kind of cross-tabular format. So to do so, first of all, we define the schema. So for example, like device ID should be like long type, and timestamp should, first of all, we set the timestamp as a string type, and the speed and the accelerometer reading is a double type. So we, first of all, we define a schema, and then we passing a data by running this function. There's a function to passing a data using a from JSON. And then we specify the schema type that we defined, that is IoT underbar schema. And next, what we do is we assign a like alias name for each column to incorporate with this type of data frame. So we assign an alias name in each column here. And also, even though we get like timestamp data as a string type, but it's more we have to convert this string type timestamp into the timestamp format in order to aggregating data after that. So what we do is we specify timestamp column here, and there's a function to convert a timestamp, so-called to underbar timestamp. Then we can convert a string type timestamp into the actual timestamp format in Spark data frame. So after that, what we do is we aggregate data, which means we are going to compute our average speed and average accelerometer readings in each device ID and the time window level. So it's a kind of almost the same as the SQL's like group by function. We want to group by and the computing average in the by device ID and the time window. So we can use a Spark SQL framework to do so. But so what we do is, we specify some parameters. For example, we may set up a watermark. So we set up a watermark as 10 minutes here, which means if event timestamp is the later than like is more than like two minutes later, we ignore this data. And we can also specify, we have to also specify parameter for the times like length of time duration. We specify 5 minutes as a time duration, which means Spark structured streaming keep aggregating data every 5 minutes record according to the event timestamp given from the streaming data. And we specify the which column I want to compute the average. So, and eventually we can output the final data. Sorry, character is a bit small, but so what we can see here is this is an aggregated result. So we can see this is a device ID, and this is a time window. For example, like 9 a.m. to 9:05 a.m. And these are values averaged in average value of the speed and the accelerometer readings. So Spark structured streamings keep aggregating the data given the input stream data. So as you can see, like in batch 3, you can find a multiple record in device ID, which first one line is a device ID 10's aggregated record from the 9 a.m. to 9:05 a.m. And next record is aggregated data for device ID 10, but this is a different different time windows aggregated to data in same device ID. So by doing by using this framework, we can compute this kind of we can do this kind of data aggregation. And even not only just printing output to the standard output console, but also we can output data to the Kafka another Kafka topic. So we can we do is we just write a function for the one-line function, write stream output mode, and we specify Kafka format, and we specify Kafka broker, and output topic name, which is different from input topic name. So we we receive a data from topic A, and the Spark process a data. Then after that, Spark can send back data to the Kafka with another topic. For example, topic B or topic C or anything that we can specify. And not only output to Kafka, we can also output other data stores. So Spark provides some like connector to store the diverse data source. Elasticsearch is a WAMS example. Even we can dump a data frame data into the Elasticsearch by using this provided framework. So basically syntax is very common. We write a stream and the format, specify format, which is ES, Elasticsearch, and we specify Elasticsearch host name, port number, and document name, index and document name. So which means we can write a program to dump output to diverse data source, and the syntax is very consistent, so we can easily write a program to do that. So this is a last example for today's session. So I also create a simple demo to do a tweet sentiment analysis. So previous example is basically just aggregating data, which is kind of very similar to just what SQL do, SQL does. But not only SQL-like process, but also more complex logic can be implemented on the Spark structured streaming. So I'm going to explain a detail here. So first of all, we have to get our tweet data from timeline. So for as a producer, so what I create is the I just import and set up some Kafka parameters, what I did in a previous example. And to get the real-time tweet data, I use a Twitter API credential and access to the endpoint to get a tweet to extract a tweet which appearing in my Twitter timeline. Then I just use a Twitter API to get the data which is a JSON format, and then I'm passing some like original data extracted from Twitter, and just sending, do some data manipulation and sending data to the Kafka. So you don't need to care about this logic. This logic is basically original data from Twitter is a very big JSON file, so I try to like squeeze it. That's all. And just sending data by using a producer.send method. It's the same as what I did in the previous example. Sorry, this is a Japanese Twitter example, sorry, because I'm using a Twitter with a Japanese language. So, but basically, yeah, what I send to Kafka is this kind of data format. So first field is a tweet ID, and this is a nested JSON format. Tweet property has a multiple field. One is the username, and tweet body, and also a timestamp when this tweet is created. So basically what producer just sending this kind of JSON data to the Spark structured streaming. as what we did in previous example, Spark structured string pull a disk data from the Kafka broker. So this part is almost the same as the previous example, like, yeah, just calling a spark.readstream method and specify Kafka parameters. And the here we also like convert that like streaming data into the stream data into the string format here, and they are passing data. But here, so original this data is a nested JSON format. So to incorporate with the nested structure, I write a code to flatten this nested structure. So then, so as we did last time, we defined the schema of the data JSON data format, and after we define a schema, we pass the data as we did last time. Okay, next, what we are going to do is first of all, we need to tokenize a tweet body, and computer sentiment score. So in this example, I'm using a dictionary-based sentiment analysis. So I don't build a machine learning model, but I use a dictionary to identify which word has a like, positive nuance, and which word has a negative nuance, and how much degree they are. But anyway, to do so, first of all, we have to like tokenize the text. So, but tokenize the text in Japanese is a bit troublesome because there is no white space between the word. So I write up a program to tokenize the Japanese text, but it's a bit long, so I don't introduce here. But anyway, I create a class so-called Japanese tokenizer. And I use this Japanese tokenizer in this Spark on the to run the on this Spark structured streaming. But to do so, we have to make it defined as the UDF. So we define a Python function here, but to run the PySpark, we have to make it a UDF. Then I run this tokenizer function on top of the data frame that I passed earlier. So what I do is I specify this UDF tokenize function, and the input data is a tweet. So fetch tweet, okay, tweet come from this one. So this is a past data, and this is a body of the tweet. So I give a tweet body as an argument for this UDF. And also I write a function to compute the sentiment score, and I also have to make it a UDF here. And I'm also doing the same, running a UDF function here. So I define a UDF, so-called UDF underbar get underbar pn underbar scores. So I run this function on top of this tokenized tweet to compute a sentiment score. So this is a result of the sentiment analysis. So I change some like tweet ID and the username for some confidentiality. But and sorry, I suppose many of you cannot read Japanese. But yeah, what I did, what we get is okay. We get tweet ID and the name of user who tweeted this one, and this is a timestamp, and this is a sentiment score. So as I have been showing this, so we can implement a bit complex logic by defining a Python function and make it UDF and to run the Spark structured streaming. So not only SQL-like process, but also we can do implement this kind of logic, and even we can use pre-trained machine learning model by using a Spark MLB. Yeah, so that's all for today. So in summary, so we can use a Python to implement the stream processing using this framework, and hopefully my demo might be helpful for you to understand what's going on and implement your own streaming data pipeline. Yeah, let's have a fun and play with the streaming data. Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Takanori, for your talk. So, do we have any questions from the floor? Any questions? Does anyone have any questions? If not, then...
Oh!
Can you implement logic on Kafka itself already? Or do you sort of have to implement any logic?
Sorry, could you repeat your question?
So basically, like now the messages are coming in, or the stream is coming in.
Mm-hmm.
Do you like implement logic on the Kafka level already, or do you need to like pass it through, and then you have to implement any logic in Spark?
So basically, what we need to do is we need to create some like a function to send the data to Kafka broker, and. Also need to create a program to pull a data from the Kafka broker as a consumer side. But this kind of message queuing is handled by Kafka framework, so we don't need to explicitly writing a logic to handle kind of message queuing.
Any other questions? The slides will be sent to you after the whole conference about in 1 week after the conference. So no worries about that. Any other questions? Okay, if not, you guys can find Mr. Takanori, like apparently if you guys want. And please join me.